got some natives from Queen Anne's County, and they're going to tell you stories about where we are today. Now, I'm not going to take away any of the surprise. First, we'll do introductions, and then we're going to go back 50, maybe even 60 years, and tell you a spot that you can visit that has a fantastic Eastern Shore and Queen Anne's County history. Bill, how about you start out with some introductions?
My name is Bill Denny, and a beautiful lady next to me will tell you her name.
I'm Kay Maloney.
And Kay, you're a very brave woman to sit between these two men. I want you to know that, all right?
Okay. We're very innocent.
She didn't tell me that.
Okay. Yeah, I'm Nick Hoxter.
Thank you, Nick. Now, Bill, let's start with you. First of all, tell the audience, where are we? I mean, obviously, it's a beautiful scenery. We've got ships to the left. We've got the Bay Bridge. Where are we? And we'll start with that.
As far as I can find out, I haven't been here that much, only about 2,000 or 3,000 times. But anyway, as far as I know, we're at Matapeake on the left side of where the boats docked.
And we're looking at the old ferry boats.
With the old ferry boats docked. And I used to be a Boy Scout, and we camped right in this area at Troop 164. And I love the Boy Scouts, and I love my tent, and I love the guy that was a leader. We had a couple guys that were leader. One was David Jones. He was assistant leader. And then we had another guy, and I can't remember
Teeny Jones.
His name. Yeah, Teeny was one.
Now, we're talking 30s, 40s. Yeah, help me calendar-wise.
We're talking 70 years ago.
Oh, 70 years ago. Okay.
70 years ago. In fact, I'm not too sure there weren't a couple Indians around here.
Okay. There might still be a couple.
We were all scared to death when we went to bed at night in our tents, our little pup
tents. Tents right here, where we're sitting now.
Okay. Right here, right exactly where this table is. And, of course, we had our little fires and so forth and so on. And we tried to bake potatoes, and we tried to cook scrambled eggs. And actually, I think I ended up eating a raw potato. And the egg, I had to consider it a while, but I think I finally ate a raw egg.
Okay.
But I was hungry.
You'd eat anything.
Eat anything. When you're young like that, you're awful hungry.
You didn't care.
And we really enjoyed it. But I better let the lady know.
Well, Kay, how about your earliest memories here?
I don't remember the site at all.
Okay.
I'm much younger than these guys.
I can tell.
He said 70 years ago. I'm like, well, I was just being born. So
okay.
I was looking for the plaque for where his tent was because he said it was right here.
I think the raw egg is here.
The shell's here.
I always had the other side where the manor house is.
And you would have been going there, what, in the 50s? Late 40s?
50s.
Okay. So that's your early memories. Now, is with family?
And getting on the ferry boat.
Okay, so taking the ferry across.
And sitting here waiting for people to get off the ferry boat to pick them up.
Okay, all right. Now, family would come here or not, or just for the ferry?
We came for the ferry as a family, but I came down as a teenager with the girlfriends.
And this was a hang, what, for swimming?
For swim. You could still go over there and swim.
Okay.
Everything was gone as far as the ferry boats and all.
Right.
But they still had the steps. They still had the beach. So you could still go in and out and swim over
now,
there.
Now, like these guys, did you ride bikes or how'd you get down here?
I lived too far to ride a bike.
Okay.
So
Okay. Somebody
had a car.
Okay, so
or a parent brought us down and then came back and picked us up. See, in the 50s, you could do that.
Oh, yeah, okay.
And your kids were safe.
And you were going at that time, would it be Stevensville High? Or
yeah.
Okay, so you were at Stevensville High.
Stevensville High.
Okay, so Bill's with the dinosaurs. You're in the 50s, which some of us can understand. When did you start out, Nick, coming down here?
Evidently, I must be the old man because I can remember being here in the 30s.
Okay, he's prehistoric.
I was going to say 30s. BC or AD, Nick? Where are we?
Well, it's up for the vote, evidently. I remember coming here in the 30s.
What was here in the 30s? I mean, would you close your eyes and open them again? Hey, it's almost the same place, or what?
Oh, this is very similar because it's not being used much, as you can see. There were picnic tables, and the ferry system had put a well in, a pump well.
Okay.
And we'd come here for birthday parties, especially. My dad would bring a truckload of the children down from Stevensville, and we'd come down here, and we'd have birthday cakes, and they fix hot dogs, and we swim in the bay.
Now this was privately owned. This is where the ferry boats came in. Was it owned by them or?
It was the part of the ferry system.
Okay.
This had been the farm of Archie Lay, and it ran all the way over to where. Oh my goodness! I guess the I'm trying to think who owns it today. Denny. What was a doctor, Bill? Doctor?
In other words, across here would be where Jenks Lake owned later, and it's an old brick house.
Yeah, but Dr. Novak was the one that...
Dr. Novak is down the road a little bit to the right,
and
he lives in a really an old, old home.
There was no problem just... I mean, well, anybody could come if they wanted to.
Three farms were purchased because they didn't know which one where they were going to build
the
ferry system. Okay, the
docks, okay.
Mm-hmm. And, but they bought the Archie Leg farm. It was in the middle, and that's the one they used. But I used to come here, as Billy said, the Boy Scouts, we came here. We did a jamboree here, as local. We cook. We have to learn our cooking. We'd have to learn swimming, and all this had to be done. But we used this side, the south side, because the north side, the transit people knew about it, and they would go there.
Okay, so that was fairly crowded.
Yeah,
yeah. Okay.
Yeah. So we used this side.
And it had the old building there that we fixed up.
Okay. Yeah.
So this was just trees and beach and water.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah,
yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, and a pump. And a pump we could use.
You could get the water. Okay.
Yep.
Now, let me go back to you, Bill. So, go back to your raw eggs.
Raw eggs.
Now, literally, we're talking about you come here, camp out for a couple of days or a week or a night? Or?
Well, we camped. The most we did when real young, I was just 12 years old. And Keller Hoxter, I remember his name, was...
no relation.
One M.
No, okay, not one of those. Okay.
He was the one that was ahead of us and brought us down and... Very nice guy and put up with us. And we didn't know how to light a fire, let alone how to cook a potato. And I worked and worked and worked on trying to light this fire. And he said, he insisted.
Did you have matches or just?
No, just wood and rubbing it back and forth.
The old Boy Scout way to start a fire. Okay.
Just like a little bow and a stick turned back and forth. And I got a little smoke. But it never did light the fire.
Okay.
So while he was walking over looking at something else, I pulled a safety match out of my pocket and lit the fire.
And you got your merit badge anyway.
And he came back and says, look, Bill Dan's got a fire going there. And I said, yeah, boy, it was rough too. And the next thing you know, he's promoting me to be patrol leader.
Oh, Lord.
And I didn't even know
Thank
how to
you,
light a fire.
Safety matches.
Yeah, safety matches. But anyway, we had a lot of fun and we learned a lot. And he actually put up with us.
Okay.
Because we weren't exactly angels way back there.
Now, and you could see camped out in the beach, different?
Actually, this bank here is probably original, but then from there on down was a sand beach.
Oh, so you could actually
swim right
there.
And went right out into the water, no bulkheading, no fill and everything. And you go down here, and I believe there might have been steps over here somewhere, and we went out there, and then we swam way out. It was sort of flatty out here, and I remember going out a pretty good bit, and I was showing off. I learned how to swim at camp, so I was curving around there, you know, swimming, you know. And my aunts and uncles, and they were, boy, Billy, you're a good swimmer. Well, I can only swim from here to that tree, but I did the best
I could. You were looking good.
Yeah, I looked good on 100
feet, you were good. Okay, now let me go back. So you're talking, you were a teenager, 50s. So tell me, what was it like being, help me with the dates.
Yeah, I was in high school. That was when high school started, seventh grade.
Oh, okay.
I did the first 6 years at the old Stevensville Elementary, which is the big white building.
Right.
And then we went to the Stevensville High School. The high school he graduated from became our junior high school. It was attached to the main school, but it had a breezeway. But we had our 7th and 8th grades, and the cafeteria was put in there in what used to be their auditorium. And so that was, and then when we got into 9th grade, we went over into the building that they're tearing apart and rebuilding. I saw that eagle. Did you see that?
It's a bald eagle.
It was a bald eagle. There's a bald eagle right there.
There he is. Look, there he is.
As long as he doesn't take my hat.
Okay. No, he's circling. See his white tail?
Mm-hmm. Look at that.
He doesn't like us making so much noise.
No, this is private.
Yeah, we're in his domain.
So you went
and then I was over there for graduate, and then I graduated from Stevensville High School.
Okay, all right.
And our class at the time was one of the largest classes to graduate.
Now, how many
had 36.
Was that? 36. Uptown, right? You were up
there. Yeah, they got bigger behind us, but that was before. When people just started with the building and the development, and people
it was still
started
very rural, very
rural,
okay.
very small.
Well,
lived on farms down here.
Okay. Now, I've heard from the guys for three shows about what the guys did for the teenage years. A lot of them we couldn't put on the air. How about young women? What was the? I mean, were there dances? What was Stevensville?
We had school dances.
Okay.
We had all kinds of dances at school. You know, each class would put on a certain you know, spring fling or the, you always
some
had a dance.
Dance.
Yeah, you always had some kind of dance going on. And then the juniors would do the senior prom. They were responsible for giving the seniors the prom. And so each year, that's how it was handled. You raised the money in the junior year to pay for the senior year prom.
Right, which is still what they do now. That's what they still do now. No,
now it's only, this year was just a senior prom, I was told.
Oh, is that
told.
Right? Okay.
But you have to buy tickets and go somewhere.
They, some of they took the it off campus. Yeah, it was crazy.
Yeah,
but I mean,
crazy.
It was like what? Hop in a car. I mean, with that. What were the hangouts for the young women?
You had Tasty Freeze.
Now tell me where Tasty Freeze was.
It's where, what's that building?
Well, Free you know where? With Kenai United Methodist Church.
You know where the Methodist Church is, and right on that corner was a Tasty Freeze.
Okay, that was a hangout.
That was a hangout. Well, you stayed in the car and rode around.
Okay.
you hope you weren't the guy that had a cool car. You know, you always had to do it. I started dating the gentleman that the guy I married when I got out of school. I started dating him when I was 15. So we went to Easton off and on too, because that was where the movie theater was, the closest movie theater.
No movie theater. Stu was in a movie
And nobody
theater.
Went across the bridge then.
Okay.
All the kids now jump in the car and head across the bridge. We don't. We didn't do that.
You went to Easton to the movie.
Because that's where we started out. So that's sort of where we stayed. We went and they had first run movies all the time.
So Tasty Freeze, Easton movies. Okay. Anything else in?
No, in school. And you were and you did things at school. In church, those were your things that you were involved.
Women in the 50s,
60s. Sports. Here's sports.
I mean, what did you do?
I was a forward on the basketball team. You see how short I am
there.
All
right. Okay.
But we had 23 straight wins when I played.
Did you really? Okay.
But it was the old-fashioned way. Your forward stayed on
half
the court.
Half court, like they do in the Midwest. Yes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Okay. That's how we played. George Cook was our coach. He was our science teacher and our coach, and he coached us like we were a boys' team, so we had to learn to play.
He was tough.
But we played well.
So 23 straight wins.
23 straight wins.
Very good.
We did good with that.
I think that's a record.
He got us through that.
Okay. So you were, excuse me.
And then we had volleyball. That was our only two sports.
So volleyball and basketball.
He was A1 coach, George Cook.
And he was a high school coach. Mm-hmm. What did he teach, phys ed?
He taught science, and I had him for chemistry, biology. He taught that like he was in college. He made us keep the notebooks. He made us do everything. When we graduated,
he raised the level. Yeah,
he raised the level. When we graduated high school, we have what they get when they go to junior college.
Okay.
Now we were finished all that.
Mm-hmm.
And girls got out of school. You became a secretary. You went on for nurses training. You went to college. You became a teacher, or you got married.
Okay.
That was our four choices.
Four choices, and that was it. They've got a couple more now, which is
they got to thank the Lord. The girls can do anything they want.
Which is the
teaching
way it
my granddaughter. You want to be an engineer?
Do it. Do it. Now, Nick, let's go back to where we are. We just saw a bald eagle. Tell me, I mean, what were the other attractions here when you were growing up? Besides, obviously, the beach and the young girls coming. What was that?
Well, we had a movie for her time.
Yeah.
It was called the. Billy, what was it called?
Down
Opera
there
House.
To
Steamville
next
Opera
to
House.
Elementary school.
Yeah, Steamville Opera House.
The elementary school where it is now? Or?
The big white
one. It used to be a church. It used to be a Methodist church there, and it caught fire, burnt down. We've never had another another movie since that time. They keep saying they're going to bring one, but
Nick, I just remember the name. It's Whitefield Coleman.
Yeah.
And Mrs. Kerwin's. Father, I believe.
Okay.
And Bernie's Hoxter sold tickets.
Mm-hmm.
And Melvin Clark and Hop Norris operated machinery. Oh, Lord.
And it was
broken more than anything.
Let me tell you something. I'll tell you, look, I don't mean to cut Nick off.
Yes, he does. He means to do it.
I really mean to do it. Anyway, the thing was, I wanted to go to the movies and see Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs.
The Disney cartoon?
Yeah, way back there, Snow White and Seven Dwarfs. And I fell in love with Snow White.
Okay.
So I asked my
Where's
mother.
Where's this story going? I'm worried about it.
So anyway, my mother said, Billy, I'll let you go, and here's the money. And she counted out 1, 2, 3, until she got to 20 pennies. And when she got to 20 pennies, I looked at her, I said, Mom, if it costs that much to go to the movies, I don't want to go.
20 pennies?
20 cents. And I was used to getting in free because I knew the guys that owned the movie and all, and I never had to pay. But then this one time I was going to have to pay because I'd seen Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs about 6 times. So they were tartar seeing me getting a free ride, so you got to pay
sometime.
So I bucked up and went down with my 20 pennies and paid. But you wouldn't believe it, 20 cents to go to the movie.
$6 now, $8 now?
$10
and $10.
It's good what you go see.
Yeah, it's expensive.
And It was such a beautiful time.
It was
time.
A different world.
Because you actually even believe the movies, everyone in them, you know, the sneezy and sleepy
all the
and
doors.
All the drawers and sure. all. And I actually believe that. I used to go to bed at night thinking about Snow White and all the little drawers, you know. And of course,
right up in it.
when the prince came along and kissed Snow White,
right.
I jumped out of my seat. I was ready to fight him because she was my girl.
That was your girl. Don't mess with it. Nick, now look at
the old days, you know.
Nick, help us out. Now, as we look, let's go over the physical layout. Tell me about what I call the warfare.
That's a fishing pier now.
Okay, tell me, what was it? What was there when you were coming here? Anything?
No, there was nothing there.
Nothing?
No.
Okay, nothing.
No. The ships came in. Where you see the rocks and the bricks there
right.
now, they were there, but they mm-hmm. were nothing like that big.
Okay. Oh, they were a lot
yeah.
bigger.
But see, you had sometimes two ships would pass coming in there.
So the way...
At one time, okay. when he got really busy, we had five ferry boats coming in at one time, coming and going all the time. And none of this was here. And as I said, I've got pictures in my book, one of my books, of us swimming down there with the John M. Dennis coming into the... And my mother-in-law, she's there with one of...
So you're swimming while the ferry
oh,
boats
yeah.
are coming in.
Oh, okay. yeah. Yeah, yeah.
Well, we were well over this way.
You're out of the way.
Yeah. Actually,
they were behind those trees.
So the ferry boats are right between the pier and the break?
Yeah.
Okay.
Right. That's where they came in. Yeah.
Okay, right there.
Where,
right.
Like where the hole is.
Right.
And that was opened up a lot wider. But you didn't get that close to them. I mean, you're a long way away.
Oh,
we
yeah.
Were way
they,
over
they,
here.
They weren't close.
So you're saying. Now, what else was anything else gone that was here? I mean, the beach has obviously been disappeared, but
yeah.
they filled it in, it looks like.
Yeah. Where the ferries docked, they had tremendous columns that went up, and they had the cables inside to keep
okay.
them from rusting and so forth.
Right.
And later on, when they closed the ferries in 52, kids would come down here at nighttime and climb them and dive and swim down there.
Climb the cables?
Oh, yeah. They had steps going up inside. You
okay.
could get up to the side and dive. Did you ever dive, okay?
No.
Okay.
No. Women have better sense, right? Mm. Yeah, better sense.
Yeah. But, and also I wanted to say, back in our youth, this was not used except just the local people.
Right.
And over here, one day Billy and I and Melvin went looking. We had a black lady named Aunt Harriet, and she was a midwife. She delivered most of us anyway, before the doctor ever got there. She was a sweetheart.
Like
she took me to school. My first day in school, she took me because mother just had another child. And so Melvin and I and Denny went back there and looking. We got into briars up to here. Denny had gum boots on. He was the one who had good sense. We found her grave, her husband's grave, and her son's grave.
You kidding me?
Yes, we did. It's back in that woods.
And the house is back in there.
And the house is falling.
Where we are
yeah.
The house is back in there.
Yeah, it's falling all down. It was like a brown cedar shake siding. Mm-hmm.
And that was her permanent home?
Yeah, we never thought we'd find it. And the three of us went to Three Stooges, went back there. And
she was still doing that when my mom was having children, because all of us were born at home here on Kent Island.
Yeah.
And I remember coming in with my dad to pick her up.
Mm-hmm.
And then going on home. Yeah.
But it's a little cemetery with a little wrought iron fence around it, and there's a three graves in there.
And it's right, and it's still
yes,
there.
Back in
we'll go back there one time.
Yeah.
Okay, no, that bad.
Denny, you take it.
Well, we could come in the roadway.
Yeah, we could.
Yeah.
You know.
Okay, let me just go back to something. Okay, where did you go for medical help? Where was the closest hospital?
We had Dr. Sattamar. We didn't have to go to a hospital.
Oh, yeah. And he did home call.
He delivered mother had seven children, six living, and he delivered the six living. All of us, at home. And in fact, the house that's still on Dundee Avenue where I was born, it was four of us born in that house.
Okay.
And it's still there. I only live a couple miles from where I was born. I haven't moved far.
It's too pretty to move. Why would you move?
Yeah.
So, if you, a real emergency, I mean, no, the old days.
A real emergency. Yeah. I had a brother who had some serious illness problems, and he would have to go to Hopkins.
Oh,
but
so you have to go across?
Dr. Sattamar made all the calls, and my father and all would take him. And when he'd be in the hospital over there, my mother would get on the Trailways bus and go to Baltimore.
Go all the way around.
No, after the bridge went in. She could catch the bus and go on. That was in the 50s. After 52. Mm-hmm. And she'd go over on the trailways and then catch a cab, go into Hopkins. But okay. then she was so, they were so used to her being on the bus. The bus driver, when he'd get to Shamrock Road, he'd just pull on the side because my mother would be asleep and you'd say, Miss Nash, time to get out.
Time to get up.
And they would get her off the bus and she'd walk on home.
Okay, all right. Yeah. So Easton didn't have a hospital?
Yeah, Easton had a hospital.
No, Easton or Annapolis, mostly Easton. But really and truly, Dr. Sattamar, which fought against us in the First World War, and he came over.
For real? He was in the Germans?
He was actually German. He was German anyway, but he was against us in the First World War. Second World War, I think Dr. Benton, who was a doctor on Kenan, got him over here, and he married Dr. Benton's
daughter.
Right. And anyway, every time something happened to me, I go right over to Doc Sattamar. He lived right across from the
garage. Just knock at the door.
Yeah.
Just knock at the door.
And he had
office hours right there in his
house,
too.
But he was there most of the time.
Oh, yeah.
Except every now and then he'd go down to the pool room and drink a Budweiser. But other than that...
I'll tell you how good a doctor he was. My brother, who had a bleeder's disease, before we knew he had a bleeder's disease, we had an accident going home from the ferry boats dropping somebody off one time, and we hit a pole, and he went through the windshield. And they couldn't get his head to stop bleeding. And one night, he got down to the house, and he said, we're going to do something. And we were all locked, you know, pushed in, and the doors closed. They laid him on the kitchen table, and our neighbor held him down, and he went into that cut and found the artery and tied it off.
Tied it right at the house.
Right at the house.
Mm-hmm. Listen, let me tell you how good he was. In 1949, I was in an accident. I went through a windshield. And Lewis Crouch happened to come by, picked me up, put it in the car, took me up to Doc Sattamar's. He was there lighting a cigar. He come in and said, Dom, boy, what the hell happened to you there? And I said,
so he had a strong accent.
Oh, very strong.
He said,
let
me look there. Sit in the chair. So I sat in the chair, and he started threading the needle. And he said,
it'll stitch you right up there.
He said, wait a minute, let me get the ear first. The ear was throbbing. It was going. It was cut off. And it was just going, you know. And I'd go in there until the day he died. As soon as he'd see me, he'd say, let me see that ear. And he would pull
it.
But he took 42 stitches in me. He never gave me a shot. He never gave me anything. And many years later, my son fell and busted his head. You could actually see the bone in there. It was so bad. He was around to live down to Love Point to the...
Buckles,
having his nightly beer before
Buckles.
He opened up. Yep. And I called him. He said, I come down. So he came around, and he sewed his head up. And I said, aren't you going to give him anything? Nah, he's all right. So he sewed him up. But his wife told me, he came home one day, and he was bleeding. She said, what happened to you? So Dom said, I went through the windshield. Said, you went through the windshield? Yeah, Dom, go back somewhere. So he said, went in. She went in there, and he took the needle, sewed it up. So what are you going to do? I'm going to sew it up. Said he sewed his head.
Yeah. Did himself.
Yeah. And he had a great big scar. Mm. And I said, where'd you get that? Dueling. I said, didn't it hurt? Dom, right, it hurt, but it's honor.
It's a sign of manhood. Right?
Yeah, that's right. Yeah.
Which is great.
Yeah.
Bill, let me go back to you. Okay, you want to say something?
Well, when I was learning how to ride my bicycle, I went down the hill by the garage, and I wound her up. I was really going good. And I was wobbling, and I went around the corner, and here is a car sitting there. It stopped, and I hit the car head on, flew over the handlebars, landed on the hood, and when I landed, I was upside down. Then I got straightened out. I looked through the windshield, and who looking out at me was Dr. Sattamar. He says, boy, you're reckless with that bicycle. And he didn't know if he'd kill me or not. He got out of the car, and he got a hold of me. I was only about this tall. I'm a little taller than that now. But anyway, anyway, he got a hold of me and shook me a little bit. And he says, boy, you're all right. I said, yes, sir, Doc. I'm really sorry I ran into you. He said, better you run into me than somebody else, you know.
He says, the doctor.
Because he was stopped, and he was the doctor. And he checked me all over.
And you were fine.
And I got back on my bike and said, thank you, Doc.
And kept going.
And the reason he did it. He was looking to some girl, because every girl to him was Shuggy. Shuggy.
Snow White, I thought.
No, well, Snow White, but he called him Shuggy. Yeah.
Okay, all right, okay. I hate to tell you, but Betty Benton lived right across from there.
She's gone.
And
ears
like
are ringing,
Betty.
Right? Ears are ringing.
I like Betty, and I was trying to be a man, you know. Yeah. And I was only like 6 years old, you know. And I didn't even know how to ride a bicycle. And finally, I was going to give it up. I scraped my knuckles on the side of the garage, the cinder blocks and all. And I told Mr. Freddie Carter, who lived right down the road from us, I said, Mr. Carter, if you can find a sale for this bike, you can sell it. I'm not going to ride it anymore.
Kill myself.
And then about an hour later, Mr. Carter sees me and I'm riding my bike again. He said, didn't take you long to get over that little accident. But I finally learned, you know.
Be careful. Nick, let me go back to you. Now, look, Kay already talked about Tasty Freeze.
Mm-hmm.
Tell me, what were some of the other hangouts?
Well,
when
we were in high school, P&S had a luncheonette.
And tell me about, where was that?
It was right next to the P&S garage, which is right across in Duke Street today.
Okay.
Then, in our time, that was in Duke Street. That was Babe Denny Landing Road. And on a corner there, Shields, another German. He had a wonderful restaurant. The hamburgers were like 20 cents or 25 cents. And they were that big. I'm not kidding you. They were. So we didn't have a cafeteria in school, so we went there and ate.
You left the school and went to the restaurant?
Yeah, it just went right around. It was next door there.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
We never had a cafeteria.
School. Okay.
No. Parallel with the school property.
Okay. So it was easy to get to.
Oh, yeah. Easy to get to. And then my last year, they opened the White House restaurant. Mm-hmm. Al McCoubry and his wife. But remember, if we wanted to go to a movie, to Graysonville, we walked. It was only 7 miles and 7 miles back.
We didn't think of anything.
We were a different generation. Yeah. You had to do things, you know, and that.
You had a movie in Graysonville.
Yeah, we had one in Graysonville.
That's where the post office is.
Yeah.
Okay. Where the post office is now.
Yeah.
Okay. That building.
Yeah. All right. Yeah.
And then there was one in Queenstown. Because I remember as a little girl going to the one in Queenstown and ducking under the seat when the airplane came toward me. And then there was one in Centerville. Because I went up there.
Bill Moore has always told me about
that. I was a teenager. I did have, you know, we went up there a couple times.
They had a bowling alley there too, Kay? Is that true or not?
Bowling alley? No, I don't know if it's in Centerville.
Maybe I'm wrong.
Churchill had a movie.
Was it?
I don't remember.
But once ours burnt down,
we weren't allowed
they never
in
opened
there.
It.
I don't believe
the
that.
The only bowling alley I remember is where...
Stuart Palmer had one down in Stevensville.
No
he
place.
He had two alleys.
Yeah. No place.
I mean, was there a rival? If you were a Ken Islander, mm-hmm. the Centerville game, I mean, was that a big rivalry? I opened up a can of worms here. What you got?
They were mostly... The boys didn't like us. The boys didn't like us.
The Centerville boys didn't like
it.
They
did not like it, but the girls, I mean, you couldn't get home.
Now, Kay, you tell me the truth. Was there a rivalry?
Oh, yeah.
Ours was in sports, yes.
Yeah,
we had a big
rivalry
because we always felt like, okay, they were the county seat. They got all the good stuff. We got the leftover. Southernsville even got leftover behind us. So
Centerville, Ohio,
Centerville was always the one you wanted to beat.
Okay.
They were always the ones you wanted to beat.
Stevensville boys, they were farm boys.
Okay.
Waterman sons, and oftentimes they didn't come to school for a while. They didn't even get to practice sometimes. And then Friday or one other time come we played. But it was a rivalry. But when World War II ended and all the boys came home, Centerville and Ken Island became like this. The Centerville boys would come here and play on our teams, and it was a different,
Okay.
Yeah. So time heals all wounds.
Yeah,
and a war. Yeah.
And a war. Didn't you catch? Hmm. Didn't you catch one
no,
of these?
No, I played left field and right field, and played soccer wing.
Okay.
But the only reason I was a pretty good soccer player was I couldn't kick the ball that far, and I could dribble a little bit. But the main thing is I could run, and those guys were big. So actually, I was running with the ball to kick it down the field, you know.
Okay.
But mainly, I was trying to save my life. Those guys were big.
Okay.
So you could
outrun them, right?
Oh, I could outrun them. And they'd look around, where'd he go?
I was the big guy. I was the one that fouled. I fouled out of every basketball game I played until my senior year because I just played rough.
He played hard.
That's good. George Cook taught you that.
He did. He told me if I could push him out and get away with it, do it.
Do it. Now, Nick, as usual, our time's up. Where are we going to go next time? You got something? Kay, where are you going to let these guys take me next time? Well, you know you're welcome, all right? You keep them calm, all right?
Okay. Do I?
We got Roman Coke to go to.
Well, you guys organize,
Wherever you want to go. We didn't finish here either. We didn't go to the pier.
Well, we can
down,
do a part two.
The ferries came in.
Okay. Let me stop for now, or my engineer's going to throw me into the water, okay? Thank you guys very much. We're going to do this again, okay? I hope, all right? I'm Fred McNew. You've been watching QAC TV7. We're going around Kent Island, giving you some of the past history, whether it's a Tasty Freeze or an old movie. I guess we probably do a whole thing on Bill's love of Snow White, maybe the future date. And Kay will keep them straight, I hope. Okay. Fred McNew, we'll see you next time. Thank you for your time.